This is Tim, and Tim is an aspiring geometer. Tim is flat, which means he only exists along two axes and has no breadth. Tim decides to try out a few experiments to understand the nature of his world, and he makes some interesting observations. First, he places a flag on the ground and walks in a straight line. He finds that after some time, he reaches the very same flag that he placed. He tries the same experiment a few more times with walking in different directions, and finds the same result each time. What Tim does not realize is that he's actually stuck on a sphere. In fact, he cannot even properly conceive of a sphere due to his two-dimensional nature, but we as three-dimensional observers can watch him go in a circle. One interesting consequence of this is that if Tim's vision were good enough, he may even be able to see himself from behind. Now would be a good time to mention that Tim is working off of a definition that states a straight line is the shortest distance between two points. For Tim, straight lines are what are known to us three-dimensioners as a geodesic. A geodesic is the shortest distance between two points on a sphere or curved surface. And on a sphere specifically, straight lines, when extended, will always create a circle with a diameter equal to the diameter of the sphere. These circles are also called great circles, and they are essentially the largest circle that can be drawn on that sphere. From Tim's perspective, he finds that for any straight line he produces, if he walks at the same speed, it always takes the same amount of time for him to return to the point from where he started the line. Tim is intrigued by these findings and uses his flat cell phone to give his geometrically knowledgeable friend Al a call. Al exists on a regular flat plane, and he's confused by Tim's claims, but he brushes them off and says, "If you want to understand geometry, you should draw two parallel lines." "But what's a parallel line?" Tim asks. And he's told that they are two straight lines which never intersect. Okay, Tim thinks, that should be easy enough. The world is unbounded but finite, so I just have to draw two straight lines that traverse the world but never meet. He sets off and draws a straight line until it meets itself, and then considers where to start the next line. You might think that from our higher dimensional perspective, he could simply create a smaller circle that is parallel to the great circle he has drawn. However, if you recall the definition of a straight line, then the shortest distance between any two points on the smaller circle is not the line that is drawn. Here you can see an example of the line that is actually the shortest distance between the two points. Given this fact, whenever Tim tries to construct another line that is parallel, he finds that his lines always intersect in exactly two points. We've been speaking of straight lines for Tim when they clearly look curved to us, and it's actually not possible to depict exactly what Tim sees. Whenever we map things from a sphere to a 2D plane, like a map of the Earth from the globe, various distortions occur based on the type of mapping. Here's a sphere that shows Tim's attempts at making parallel lines. If we project these points in an equirectangular projection, this is one way of visualizing what Tim sees. Here the distortion is greatest at the poles. We can also create a stereographic projection to display it another way, and the distortion increases as you move away from the center. Neither of these approaches are correct or incorrect, they are just ways to help us display what Tim is seeing from his perspective. Concluding that parallel lines do not exist, Tim shares his findings. Al suggests that he next should try to make a triangle and measure the angles because, for all triangles, the interior angles should add up to two right angles. So Tim gets to work. Once again, we cannot simply project a 2D triangle onto the sphere to visualize the triangle, the lines must be arcs of great circles. And when Tim creates these intersections of great arcs, he finds that contrary to Al's claims, the interior angles of the triangle are always greater than two right angles. Not only that, but the larger the triangle is, the greater the interior angles are. Surely, at the very least, you cannot draw more than one straight line through the same two points, Al proposes. Tim once again experiments and finds that when he chooses two random points on his sphere, he is in fact only able to draw one straight line through them. He feels relieved that he finally found something consistent with the geometry defined by his friend. That is, until he remembers that when he attempted to create parallel lines, there were two intersections. In fact, he further finds it is the case that for any antipodal points, an infinite number of straight lines can be drawn through them. At this point, it seems that Al and Tim have very different rules for geometry, and matters are only made worse when Tim's cousin Henry joins in the call. Henry heard some details of the conversation up to this point, and declares that they are both wrong. All triangles have angles that add up to less than two right angles. And when given a straight line, an infinite number of parallels can be drawn through a point next to that straight line. Both Al and Tim are vexed by these preposterous claims and decide there's only one way to settle the matter: present the findings to the great geometer. The three animals compile their lists of observations and present them to this being. "Which of these are true?" they ask. The great geometer responds with this: With this, the great geometer finished speaking, and the animals were left dissatisfied, not knowing who was right. This story helps demonstrate how ideas we believe to be fundamental or axiomatic may in fact be definitional, and it shows how equally valid conclusions can arise from various definitions. In our own world, we find uses for Euclidean, hyperbolic, and other geometries, and there may be more helpful geometries that we have yet to discover. Just as the animals struggled with what was true for their world, one must determine the value of usefulness and physical correspondence in assessing truth. Thank you all for watching the video, and thank you to my supporters on Patreon. Until next time.